SF Prototyping Futurology Congress just started. Science fiction prototyping is a practice of using various stories, fiction, images, and products to envision other possibilities for the present and future using the imagination of science fiction. This practice is now beginning to be adopted by a variety of companies. In Japan, there are few books on science fiction prototyping, and there is not much research on it in a systematic way, but various practices are taking place here and there. What is SF prototyping all about? It is still unknown. If that's the case, then let's invite those who are actually practicing and researching SF prototyping to a congress of the possibility of SF prototyping. So, the value, the challenges, the future, and the needs of SF prototyping will be discussed from the four roundtable discussion: narrative, art, business, and world. This is the fourth edition of the conference, World SF Prototyping, where we'll be discussing SF prototyping from practice in China and the US. The chairperson for this session is Dojin Miyamoto, a writer on science fiction and culture, and Yuki Namba from the Kobe University and studying the philosophy and aesthetics. And also me, Hirotaka Osawa, an assistant professor at the University of Tsukuba. I'm studying at human-agent interaction. And Dr. Miyamoto and Mr. Namba, thank you for joining us today. I believe both of you are participating in the sci-fi prototyping futuristic studies conference from your own research practice. So what would you like to discuss with our three guests today?
Nice to meet you. And I am Namba Yuki. So I'm a philosopher of art and a philosophy of aesthetics. And I'm so interested in sci-fi prototyping and sci-fi from the viewpoint of philosophy. So especially what is science fiction, or what is the uniqueness of science fiction, and how the science fiction can affect our lifestyles or our view or worldview. So I'm studying about science fiction from the philosophy, and I now work with Osa-san and Miyamoto-san about sci-fi prototyping. So I'm very interested and I am very excited to talk with Ru-san and Jansen. So, yoroshiku onegaishimasu.
Okay, then start to the doujin. Yeah.
So, hi, I'm Dojin Miyamoto. I'm very interested in Chinese science fiction prototyping and American science fiction prototyping. I would like to know how sci-fi is used in each country. So I'm looking forward to talking with you today. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your patience, listeners. Now it's time to call our guest. Okay, so Professor Luz Weil, Professor Uyan, and Professor Feng Jian, nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. Yeah.
Nice to meet you.
Okay, so Wiley-san, Yan-san, Wenjan-san, could you introduce yourselves? Yeah. The Luz at first, yeah.
Thank you so much for the invitation and organizing this panel. I'm really excited to learn and share with the fellow panelists. My name is Ruth Wiley, and I am the assistant director at the Center for Science and the Imagination at Arizona State University. We are a research and outreach center, and our goal is to unite the collective imagination to think about better futures. We'll talk about this more today, but often we do that through the use of narrative, in particular science fiction stories, because they can be a great way for people to not only think about possible futures, but really think about the human impact as well. So I look forward to the panel, and thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Okay. So Professor Wu, please.
Hello. Good morning. My name is Wu Yan, and I'm a science fiction writer, also a researcher, and I teach in the Southern University of Science and Technology in Shenzhen, Guangdong Province. is very close to Hong Kong. And we have a lot of project. I will share of them later. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So Professor Zhang.
Hi, hello, morning. Very happy to join the panel. Very excited to share and learn from the guests here. I'm also working with Professor Wu at the Center for Science and Human Imagination at Southern University of Science and Technology in Shenzhen. We are working on some projects related to science fiction education, science fiction industry, and also science fiction development with the urban development, economic development. And also, so I'm looking forward to today's panel because I have been, you know, looking at this sci-fi prototyping for a long time. So I want to learn from Russ and also the panelists today to try to, you know, make use of this concept in China more and more. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So most of all of the guests is very bright. Starting studies of the science fiction prototyping with the academic people. So at first, I want to make a question about the practice and research for this area. So I want to start with the Professor Wu about the question. So what kind of the research do you do at the Science Fiction and Human Imagination Research Center? So Futurology has not been sufficiently studied in Japan. So yeah, I want to ask about the question on here.
So I have a PowerPoint and to show what kind of things we did, we do in our center. And right, I will share of that. You know, the Research Center for Science and Human Imagination is a center attached inside the Southern University of Science and Technology. And the main work is to explore imagination or the issues related to imagination. And I will give you some very brief introduction of our historical milestones and curriculum and teaching and research and international exchange output and social services. And the first is we built on the 2017, at December of 2017, at that year, I moved from Beijing to Shenzhen and work in Shenzhen. Originally, I work in Beijing Normal University for many years. I create the sci-fi teaching program at that university from undergraduate level to graduate level and to doctor level. But then I quit. I moved to Shenzhen and to build this center. And we have the virtual lab in both to let people aware of virtual reality, and also we do some research about that. And we have some artistic exhibitions. Now this is we invite aliens to come to our campus and to let the student know we have the center here. And also we have some conferences. This conference is the first conference to discuss about imagination. So we attracted academics from different areas of philosophy, psychology, and brain science and different area to discuss about imagination. And also we discuss about the science fiction, the trend of science fiction. This is a conference on the situation of Chinese literature and the revolution of science fiction in the era of technology. And we also have some conferences to discuss with the current issues. Like this, I don't know how to translate that. It's a Japanese word, right? It's about the manga and the anime.
Yeah.
We call it the second dimension.
Two dimension, but it's two dimension paper imaging.
Yeah, we discussed about that. And also we have the from the frontier of science to frontier of science fiction. It's a panel. We invite scientists and science fiction writer. So you could say that Liu Cixin is here, and the science fiction world, the chief editor is here. And in this part are all scientists. So we discuss, this is the science fiction writer in my center. And we also have some, you know, discuss how to write science fiction. This is a new book release ceremony. It's by the Liu Yang, is one of our, the writer in our center. And we discuss about his new work, Offense of the Mars. And the last November, we have the Humanities Past and the Future. It's an international forum. We invite different people from different countries. So probably Ruth knows some of them. And you can see the American writers and the Israel and Canada and Italy and you know, from different country. Actually it's Sawyer,
Robert J. Sawyer
and okay, I will not yeah, that is the historical milestones of our center. And then our curriculums and teaching, we have the three kind of teachings, knowledge, ability, and action. In knowledge area, we have science fiction from fiction to film, science fiction from short story to novel. This Zhang Feng is right now is teaching the science fiction from short story to novel, right? And with the ability, we have imagination and futurology, future studies. And in action, we have science fiction, a way of thinking, and sci-fi writing. But some of the these we haven't have, but this we already have. Zhang Feng help us. That is why I invite him to join us. And we also have some lecturers from different countries and different provinces, and from Italy, David Brain, and from Hong Kong is K.Y. Wong, is also a famous researcher in the area. And our research about the imagination is covered a broad area. Because a lot of faculties from other departments, they join us. So we have a very, I think it's like in Arizona or in San Diego, you know. And right now we have the research, World Trends of Science Fiction and the Development of Sci-Fi Industry. This is executive by Dr. Jiang, who is now in working in Sichuan, you know. And also development of Chinese science fiction data bank and virtual world architecture center. We have Liu Yang and Art of the Future. And for me, it's psychology and the brain science of imagination, because my background is psychology. And then Oriental alternative science research, Science Fiction and Imagination Teaching Service Center we have, and more people is working here. And we have international exchange. This is last year, the year before I visited UC San Diego. They have a center for imagination and the chair of the center. And we also attend the Comic Con, and to join the 2001 A Space Odyssey ceremony for 60 years of the ceremony. This is the show, the 2001. And this professor Cheryl Wendt, who is also UC, but in the Riverside. And he visits our university and to show her our plan, you know, to study of the solar system. This is a professor who did this, to do the solar, you know, solar system study. And we have different outputs in different areas. This is the Nine Cities and the Millions of Futures is the exhibition of the Biennale of last year. That is the, you know, each 2 years is held in Shenzhen at the same time in Hong Kong. And our exhibition is got the awards at this exhibition. It's one output. And we have another output is the yearbook of science fiction. We evaluate this year's different issues of science fiction, and we put, you know, a lot of information of the year inside this book. So you can, only this book, you can know what's happened. And nearly the whole short stories and novels in briefing. Mm. And we also, you know, have each year we will launch this. And we have science fiction novels. And this is my novel, and this Liu Yang's novel, and this Zhang Feng's edited the Year's Best.
Year's Best.
Mm. Year's Best of science fiction of last year. It's just launched, just printed last week. We have just got that. Mm. And we also have outputs to teach science fiction in not university, but primary and secondary school. And this is the our textbook. This year we have a textbook, different in different level, different grade. We have a primary level, we have a junior high and senior high. Right now we have the, that is a very brief introduction of our center. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, it's very exciting to the so much of the science fiction work is happening in China. So I want to just ask one question. So yeah, I'm very curious about why Chinese people is now focusing on sci-fi. Is there any kind of the triggering event on the interest for the how they are how people are interested in science fiction? Is there any specific background, or is it any the more and more sci-fi funds is increased in China? So yeah,
I think the boom of science fiction mm-hmm. in China could be attributed to some factors. Some, like you said, there are some triggers, like mm-hmm. the publication of Three Body Problem, mm-hmm. which got very, you know, hot in China since mm-hmm. 2011, mm-hmm. and also the new movie, right? The Wandering Earth movie got very high box office. Mm-hmm. So in the middle, it's Liu Cixin got the Hugo Award. This news was very popular, very hot in China. So these are the triggers of the science fiction to the public and to be known to the public. And also we discussed about the background information or the possible reasons behind those events, behind those triggers, could be because we discussed about it. We thought about maybe it's because of the, you know, the scientific and technological developments of China in the recent 10, 20 years. Mm-hmm. And the science fiction boom is actually corresponding to this very fast development of technology and science in China. And people in China because we are more and more experienced, exposed to the new technology, and we feel that it's a science fiction world around us. So naturally, the interest in science fiction works could be also, you know, related to the reality in China. So that's the that could be a bigger reason why Chinese people are more and more interested in science fiction works. So the two sides of the theory, right? We've got two theories to explain the phenomena.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much, Professor Uyan and Professor Fengjian, about the story for the Chinese situation or the science fiction, interest for science fiction. So then I want to start about the question for the Luz. Yeah. So what kind of the research do you do at the Science Imagination Center? So you practice and study various science fiction workshops. So what challenges and barriers have you found? Yeah.
Thank you. I said before that I was not going to share some slides, but I was inspired by the presentation before me. So I'll share a few slides to introduce the work that we're doing, if that's okay.
Thank you.
So as I mentioned in the introduction, our goal at the center is to ignite the collective imagination for a better future. And one of the methodologies, and perhaps the primary methodology that we do this, is through stories, because we believe that stories are the building blocks that we use to make the future. And there are lots of historical examples of this. So if you look at science fiction stories, you can see the introductions of robots and submarines and rocket ships. And when we look at the world around us today, of course, we can see these examples. And it's important to note here that we don't mean that science fiction is about predicting the future, but it's about introducing new concepts and new ideas. And these ideas can become very inspirational, both for scientists and technologists, but also our general collective consciousness. And stories also allow us to do a lot of really interesting things. So we'll talk about this more in some of the examples, I hope, today. But one of the things that I think is most powerful about stories is that they're human centers. So often science fiction stories introduce great technologies and great world building ideas, but really at their core, they're about people and how they react to those technologies and what they do with them. They allow us to do prototyping, which again, we'll talk about today, and to explore these complex ideas, to ask about perhaps unintended consequences of what might happen when we introduce new concepts, and to explore different assumptions around it. They're also relatively cheap, meaning that we can explore some of these ideas without the going through the technicalities of actually building it. And we can, again, think through, is this good? Is this something that we should be doing? What are some things that we might need to be concerned about? And then also they develop a shared language. So a collaborator of the center, Neil Stevenson, once said that a good science fiction story can save you hours of PowerPoint presentations. And the idea is that when you create a good story, that people start to understand what your goal is, and they can work towards that goal without necessarily breaking it down into the individual steps. So again, a good story and a good science fiction story and a good story about the future can help us develop this shared language that reflect our shared values and our shared goals. And then finally, stories are really engaging. I also write research papers, but people read our science fiction stories way more than they read our research papers. And they reach a broader group of people. And so often in order to read a white paper or to read a research paper, people feel that they might need advanced degrees or to take a specific course in order to understand things. But science fiction stories engage a much broader public. And so there's also a lot of power in that engagement. And so often when we are developing stories, something that's really important to us is that they be technically grounded. And we also create stories towards the near future. And the idea is because we want these stories to be inspirational. We want someone who is graduating college today to perhaps be inspired by something that they read and be able to work towards it in their career. And so we typically, in the stories that we create, we set them in the near future. And in order to provide the technical background, we often pair together science fiction writers and graphic artists with domain experts across a variety of disciplines. and not just the science and technical disciplines, but also the social science disciplines. So we can talk about how might technologies be used and what will happen in society with them. So we've created a number of books and collections. Most of these are available for free off of our website. And often, in addition to having science fiction stories, they also have technical response essays from the experts that collaborate with the group. And in that way, they can be in dialogue with one another. And sometimes the technical responses can reflect on where the science is today. It can talk about how the process has shaped the conversation and shaped the field. And in addition to creating science fiction stories, we also do a number of research projects. So on the far left is a National Science Foundation project where we're developing new educational technologies, and we're doing some science fiction prototyping in real life. We also research science fiction. We had a grant from Google and Hewlett Foundation to look at how artificial intelligence was being depicted in science fiction, specifically short science fiction stories. And then we've also used what might be the first science fiction story, so Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. We did an entire project around that, around the 200th anniversary of that publication, so in 2018, looking at how we can use Frankenstein as a way to engage young people in conversations about science ethics and science responsibility. So the center isn't all about science fiction, but we definitely see it as a really powerful tool and as a way to engage people in a number of conversations. And we've been successful in getting funding and interest from a variety of organizations who also see value in this methodology and tool. And again, just really excited to share and talk with the group today.
Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, thanks. So when I and the Dojin visit to the Arizona CSI, so it's very interesting experience to learn the how this, you make a very good discussion with the citizen and also the specialists about workshops. So I want to ask a brief question. So what point do you pay attention to when you team up with the writers and also the citizens? Is there any good way to make a good method to doing this? Yeah.
Yeah, so often when we're forming our teams, we're really looking at people, they don't necessarily need to have specific sets of expertise, but need to be excited about the project and engaged in the ideas. And as I mentioned a bit earlier, we also like to bring in artists, because artists can provide a really nice addition to the teams and also bring in their own contributions on their own. And so when we're forming the teams, we often look to what are the needs of the group and how can we meet those needs with various elements. And we are now looking more for how can we engage various community groups to broaden the diversity and impact of the projects that we do.
Thank you so much for the advice from Drew. So so then we want to step to the next question, the concept of science fiction prototyping. So so for the question, I want to ask, firstly ask about Professor Fen Zhang. Is there a corresponding concept or the term for the SF prototyping in China? Or are there any similar practices?
As far as I know, the exact concept of science fiction or SF prototyping is not, has not been introduced to China yet. So we don't have a corresponding concept for this SF prototyping. But there are, I'm going to introduce this concept to China, and we are planning to translate the book by Brian David Johnson, the book by Brian into Chinese and to try to publish in China. We had this plan last year and it got some problem with the publisher, but we will try to sort out the problem and try to introduce this book to China. Because we think that this book was is the start of the whole concept, right? And we also want to introduce this concept to both China science fiction community and also the business world. So we have another plan to try to involve some business or corporations to to try to do some experiments of science SF prototyping practice in China in the near future. So we have this plan too. But that being said, I answering your question is that I think similar practices also exist in mm-hmm. China. And we will come back, I will come back with some specific examples like science fiction education mm-hmm. and like the partnership between science fiction writers and business and also with some local governments. And so some this kind of collaboration or relationship between science fiction and the practices exist in China. We do have some examples to share with you. So that's my, I think I will get back to the examples in later part of the panel. Yeah, that's the short answer to your question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, so, and I also want to ask several questions about the notion of the kepo xiaoshou. I can pronounce this clearly. So, but I hear that in China, there is originally two types of novels. That's a science fantasy novel, this ke huan xiaoshou, mm-hmm. and also science popular novel, right? Kepo xiaoshou. So, the later one is a very unknown for the Japanese people. So,
yes.
Could you explain more about this kind of how these two novels is influenced to the people and what's the kind of relationship of the two different novel style here?
Okay, to do so, I might need to share the screen a little bit
mm-hmm.
With you guys to illustrate the, you know, the concepts of these three mm-hmm. or two or three, you know, terms.
Mm-hmm.
We need to talk about science fantasy novel, science popular novel, science novel. We need to trace back to the early history of science fiction in China. The original concept, the science fiction concept, was first introduced to China as early as 1900s in mm-hmm. late Qing Dynasty. The term was first translated into Chinese by word literally. As a science novel, science novel, science mm. 科学, novel, 小说. So in the early times, people thought that this kind of fiction, this kind of novel is about science. And we, you know, in late Qing Dynasty, those people wanted to introduce science to Chinese and wanted to educate people with science. So they are very excited about this concept, science novel, right? And the translation got changed after 1949 because the new translation was from Russian term. There are three words in the new translation, science fantasy novel, with fantasy as in the middle. This translation actually was adopted from Russian term. Also partially learning from Soviet Union's system, right? In Soviet Union, there used to be an umbrella term called science, literature and art. Mm-hmm. And we adopted this umbrella concept, science, literature and art. And we regarded science fantasy novel as part of this science, literature and art, the concept. Right, the main idea was in the early times of Chinese science fiction, science fantasy novel, was to use science fantasy novel to popularize science among the people, mm-hmm. particularly among children. So the science fantasy novel, this translation got very popular in early 1950s, 60s. Later in 1970s and 80s, there was a break. There was a break during the Cultural Revolution, but before the revolution and after the revolution, this concept got very popular. And also, but the inherent conflict within this concept, within the system, broke out in early 1980s. So the science fantasy novel, this concept got got some problem in China and under the system. So after early 1980s, the science fiction community started to fight for the standalone existence outside of the previous system. And for the time being, for now, I can say that the science fiction community has reached the consensus that although science popularization could be an important part and a function of the science fiction, but by no means it should constrain the science fiction creation. So we don't really look at the science popularization as the sole or the major function of science fiction anymore. That being said, still there's a very small group of writers who insist to call their work science novel or science popular novel, as they still want to emphasize their writing purpose, which is to popularize science among children, among young readers. So in either case, I agree with the moderator that the science SF prototyping elements do exist in contemporary Chinese science fiction works. Or in other words, many science fiction prototyping works read very much like science popular novels in China, because I think the first and very important mission of this creative work is to project some specific technology and innovation into the future, and also to speculate its implications in society. So I think so everything else, like stories, like plots, like characters, the environment, is all built around this mission, right? So my presumption is that because of this tradition, the science popularization tradition in Chinese science fiction history, it might be very easy for both writers and also the receiving ends, the corporations and governments, to accept science fiction prototype concept as a new method for technological innovation for the future projection. That's my presumption. Also, that's my hope. Hopefully I answered your question.
Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, it's very interesting, especially because because Dr. Dojin is also working as a science cultural writer. So maybe this kind of connection is a very detailed explanation is very good for supporting our work to step in. Okay, yeah. So start to the roots about the question. How the widespread is the SF prototyping notion in the United States, and what is the historical position of the SF prototyping in your viewpoint here?
Yes, I think that's a great question. And one of the reasons why it's a bit hard to answer actually connects to the previous answer, which is that the ideas behind science fiction prototyping are actually done in many different ways, but it's not always called science fiction prototyping. Mm. So mm-hmm. you have other things like design fiction or speculative fiction or diegetic prototyping or futures thinking. And there are many different terms. And in fact, the work that we do, we don't always refer to it as science fiction prototyping, but they all share some similarities. So particularly, and again, to echo what was just said, they share this idea about encouraging people to deliberatively think about futures in new and interesting ways, and that they can be used in terms of educational tools, and again, in terms of broadening public participation, to recognize that the future isn't just something that other people are taking care of, but the future is something that we all need to make deliberate and specific actions in order to build collectively. And so the use of science fiction prototyping or all of the other related methods are tools to engage people in both this discourse, but also in this way of thinking about futures in specific ways. And so it can be challenging though to trace a history because these ideas pop up in many different ways, but fundamentally they share a lot of commonalities.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And I also want to ask and check the concept of sci-fi prototyping. So I think that the first read, the design fiction, is popped out by Bruce Sterling's first appearance in 2005. And then Julian Blaker, 2009 essay, Science Fiction, the Prototyping and Design Fiction, is widespread. So Ruth, you think that science fiction is an umbrella term, and there is one of the concept design fiction is held by the science fiction prototyping concepts. So design fiction is one of the science fiction.
I do think that they share this idea about world building and encouraging people to think about futures. And so when design fiction, often that is through creating tangible artifacts and creating these artifacts and not just thinking about it from a technical perspective, but also a social and cultural one. Who would want to use this? How does it change their day? Does it make it better? Does it make it worse? And so design fiction exercises, by creating those tangible artifacts, it allows people to engage in those thoughts. But narratives, straight science fiction, can also do the same thing. By reading a story, especially if that story is followed up with conversation or facilitation, but by reading a story, you can also become immersed in what these futures might be. And so again, all of these are tools that share this idea about thinking of the future, about engaging in that thought process. And then, at least in the work that we do, and hopefully amongst other work, engaging in conversation. Because I think the real power of this comes from when communities and when individuals start to speak to each other about what their future visions are, because that's when real change can start to occur.
Thanks for explaining.
Thank you very much. So yeah, I think that there's several similar notions happened in Japan, like from 1970 or something, that the famous writer Komatsu Sakio is joining on the Osaka Japan Expo and also joining some kind of creation of the vision, and several science fiction writer is also joining on the company. So yeah, so that might be many kind of ideas that the science fiction will helping our innovation or our future vision. So but might be the in the SF prototyping notion, so we are more focusing on the several aspects of the how it is contributing to the business and public agent or government. So I want to shift to the next question about these kind of relationship between the business and public agent and governance. So for example, a starting point, I want to continue about the Ruth's question. So in the United States, so it seems that there have been cases where the science fiction has been used for the long time. So from our point of viewpoint, so many attempts have been made, particularly by IT companies and also military industry. So how much do currently the United States company invest in and expected for the SF prototyping in current situation? And what kind of relationship do you think it's a good way to science fiction to get along well with companies and government and bring about innovation? Yeah.
Again, I think it's a great question. And we can see lots of examples of this feedback loop between science fiction and innovation. So we can see many scientists, technologists who talk about as young children reading science fiction and that inspiring them to pursue those careers. But then we can also see several initiatives by companies to produce their own science fiction, both to inspire their current workers and collaborators, but also the next generation. So in, I think, 2015, Microsoft produced an anthology called Future Visions that was definitely a corporate impact. ANA has collaborated with the XPRIZE Foundation to think about how science fiction can be used. As you mentioned, several companies have employed futurists and science fiction authors to be part of their boards or on their teams. I mentioned Neal Stephenson a little while ago, but he I think is the chief futurist for Magic Leap, which is a technology company. And again, it's this idea of recognizing that new ideas come from different places and that writers bring new ideas, and that especially when you collaborate and you bring people together, that that is what can lead to innovation. And so I think it is both the idea that science fiction can inspire young people to pursue these careers, but also they can provide that inspiration to people in their career to think about their work differently. And one example that we like to talk about from our work at the center is one of our first projects called Project Hieroglyph, where we paired science fiction authors with experts to create technically grounded near future visions. We had a structural engineer working with Neil Stephenson, and Neil's question was, how tall can we build a building? And the structural engineer had never been asked that question before, because when you're dealing with the practicalities, it is, what is the civil code say? What can happen? But he had never just been asked this question of, you know, not using any special materials, but just using regular steel. How tall can we build? And so he uses that as an example of a simple question posed by somebody outside of his field, which really caused him to reflect very differently on a field that he'd been studying for 20 years. And not only does it change the way that he approaches his practice, but it also has changed the way that he approaches education. So he's a professor and he now uses science fiction in the teaching of structural engineering to his course, to his students. Mm-hmm. And so this idea that there are many ways that science fiction can influence future generations as well as current generations.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. So yeah, it seems that sometimes the sci-fi writer's idea is very different viewpoint from the usual people, and especially for the government people, it's a very sometimes shocking, but maybe very innovative idea will be coming. So yeah, and I also want to ask about Professor Feng Zhen about the Chinese situation. So in China, it seems government agencies also looking at science fiction. So what kind of collaboration is taking place? And if you want to ask the Dojin, could you ask some question on here? So because you are visited about the science fiction convention, right, in China?
When I went to the science fiction convention in China, I was surprised at the number of children's fans. What are students reading as a concrete example of science fiction education?
Mm-hmm. I think the question is going to be answered by Professor Wu, who is actually on the frontier of collaboration with the government agency, also the science fiction education, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'm back, right?
The
picture. Okay, I also want to share my screen to you. Mm-hmm. And the first of all, I will share about the science fiction people involved in the different areas to help the development of real life the companies. This is one of example is our group to go to the so-called Speech Valley. The Speech Valley is in Anhui Province. Is the main work of them is to do the artificial intelligence, especially for the voice, exchange from voice to the written materials, and the group of science fiction writers come there. Came there and meeting with the different group of people, and we gave some advices to them. This is one example of last year. And the second year is very much like Ruth said, we helped the Tencent to work for the game. and to design of the game by scientific thinkings, by science fiction thinkings. This is what we call this, to science fiction and the society. And also to talking about the government support. And you know, recently government is very pay more attention to the science fiction. I have two examples. One is from 1917. Each year, government pay for a conference, you know, to annual national conference of science fiction. And at the first conference, I remember that the vice president of China, the People's Republic, joined that conference and speak at the beginning. And I still remember the first sentence is that I'm the fan of science fiction. And I want to participate this and want the Chinese science fiction to grow. This is one example. And the second example is just this year released by State Film Administration and the China Association for Science and Technology, some opinions on promoting the development of science fiction films. It's contain 10 points in different stages of science fiction movie development the government want to support. For example, to decrease of the tax, you know, to help the new technology involved in that. This is the, you know, we call this the government support. And then the sci-fi education in different level, in a university level, Chinese science fiction teaching in university have about 30 years. It's not as much as in United States, you know. Well, we learn in United States in 1950s, it already began. But at that time, it's, you know, China close to Cultural Revolution. And then after Cultural Revolution is 1976. At that time, China began to learn, oh, the whole world happened other, you know, there is other world in this planet Earth. And then began to catch the trend of the world science fiction development. So at the beginning, science fiction is from English department for learning English. I remember it's 1982. And then in 1991, I created the first science fiction course by using Chinese language in the university. And right now in undergraduate level, more and more universities have ISF courses at the present, most of them related to movie, because we found that the new generation, they don't wish to read book. You know, they prefer to watch TV and to watch the movie. So most of the curriculum by using a movie as the materials. And in the graduate level, once in Beijing Normal University, we have a program of masters and doctors. In other universities, some of them, some of their professors supervise the students in their final dissertation about sci-fi studies, but they have not the specific program for science fiction. Only in Beijing Normal University have. But when I left, they stopped that, you know. So it's now beginning from this year, Southern Universities of Science and Technology cooperate with the Hong Kong University of Science and Technology to launch a doctorate program. We have already started. So we really wish that students from different countries to come to our center to have the doctor's degree program learning. And this is the university level. And this is my classroom. So you could say many people, 160 people attend this year's curriculum, the course. And we show some pictures of the older generations writers to them. And to the level of primary and secondary school in the May of 2017, first the science fiction teaching conference teaching conference held in Beijing Jingshan School. About 500 teachers participant. This is the first big conference about teaching. And after that, conference released related to science fiction teaching was held in different cities in different years. For example, in Wenzhou, Zhejiang province, in Zhuhai, Guangdong province, and in Beijing. This is one aspect. In the other aspect, this could view as from bottom up, you know, the general teachers began to teach science fiction in their classroom. But there's another way, is the top down. In other aspects, the different levels of national or district examinations began to test the science fiction. You know, they use science fiction as materials to test the student. So that is another way to boost sci-fi teaching. And let me try to, I have some video, but I don't want to show you because I'm afraid of a collapse. One series of our science fiction, the science fiction textbook has been created. This is in primary school teaching. That is what I added. Thank you.
What do children learn through science fiction? What is the difference between the science fiction education and science education, or literature education and science fiction education?
Okay, let me answer this question. Right now, we have three levels of science fiction teaching in the K-12 area. In primary school, the most of teaching focus is to help them to protect and create the imagination. So that means a kind of a skill to imagination creation. And in junior high, we try to teach them how to move imagination into different subjects, into physics, into mathematics, and into chemistry, biology. This is the second level. And in senior high, we try to teach them by using science fiction to do critical thinking and creative thinking. That is the difference in different levels. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. And Luz, you also have a question? Yeah.
I wanted to jump in and highlight some of the remarkable similarities between the work that you shared and some of the things I've seen here. So one in particular is the government interest in science fiction during the previous administration. So in 2014, our team with some science fiction authors were invited to the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy, because they were really interested in how do you create policy for technologies that haven't been invented yet? And curious how our science fiction authors might be able to shed some light on that conversation. And that this idea that when we are creating policy, when we're creating governance, we're doing it not only for the present, but we're also doing it for the future. And so it's important to also be forward thinking in those policies. And so I thought that was really interesting. And I would love to follow up and learn more about the work of sci-fi and education in China across the different levels. I think that is something that the US schools could learn a lot from. And we know that some of the work that we've created at the center has been picked up from teachers here and there, and it shows a lot of promise for how to use science fiction in schools. But there is not, at least that I know of, a widespread use of it yet. And so again, there are great examples of individual schools or individual teachers. We created a comic book style for middle school students teaching about sustainability. And so there's great examples of one-offs, but I think that it's really important to think about how can we use science fiction more broadly and across the spectrum again, talking about how to engage young people, and not only around science, but around imagination.
Yeah, that's very important point. And I think that the educational purposes might be one of the good points for the starting science fiction. So I think that, we're also researching about several good researchers and for the different area, like virtual reality and also the AIs and also robotics. But all of the people's influence in the science fiction in the very childhood ages, with several impacts for reading science fiction or maybe watching science fiction movie or something. But this comes, things very good to making an inspiring moment for the children. So I think it's, Professor Wu and Professor Wire is also related to the education on the university. So that might be a keyword for the starting point on the science fiction in the future. Yeah, that's very powerful.
And also I want to ask Uyan-san and Huenjian-san about some gaps between the expectation of government or corporation and what the science fiction writers and some groups can make the output. So is there any gap of expectation and the output about the science fiction prototyping or some activities?
Yes, I really think this is a big gap between the government want to do and what we want to do, the whole history of Chinese science fiction, the government or intellectuals want science fiction to teach science, to communicate science. But science fiction writers always against that, think science fiction is more about that, is broader about that, So through this kind of, in 1980s, is a kind of have a movement to criticize science fiction as there is a pseudoscience. So there is no science. You don't want to teach science, is the, even up to now, it's still this kind of thinking. Mm-hmm. That is why, in different meetings, we try to tell them it's not, So last year, I still remember the year before when I invited Liu Cixin come to our university, and some people ask how you use science fiction to teach science. And he said, science communication is the first level. Mm-hmm. Is this level grown? Science fiction could grow, science fiction could be the second level, not the first level, not lower than you. Mm-hmm. That is what I'm thinking about. They still think it's a tool, but we want to say it's not a tool. It's a skill, it's a human spirit, inside that.
Thank you. And also I want to ask Benjamin-san. So Uya-san explained about the relationship government and science fiction, and especially there is some gap of company and the science fiction writers' spirit or some motivation.
In the company side, I want to share two examples. To shortly answer your question, yes, there are some collaboration between writers and corporations. And there is an interest from the company side, from the business world. Share two examples, maybe. The first one is the so-called Baidu Verne Institute. I can show a very short video. Hey, is that working?
Yes, it's working. The voice is not working, so.
The voice is not high.
It might be better to share the voice in separate options. The audio option, it's like a mic.
It's here. I see it.
Imagination defines the boundaries of civilization.
How imagination encourages us to explore dangers, opportunities.
Talks about imagination by Du Verne Plan. Scientists versus multiply science fiction writers. The the members of this institute.
My name is Andrew Ng.
What should this be?
I'm David Bren.
I'm Tian Liu.
我是陈苏帆。
我是凡尔纳计划的成员姚海军。
What's this plan about?
这是个大胆的创想。
Exciting approach.
So I think that in the future, you should be able to just go home and talk to your TV or talk to your microwave and have it understand what you want.
人工智能有可能达到两个进展，第一，让所有的车辆都自动驾驶；第二呢，有可能AI是一个很强的家政服务机器人。
A machine collaborate with an author in writing a novel.
百度大脑可以对接不同的垂直领域，比如说自动驾驶。智能参谋可携带。Will
artificial intelligence influence our life in the future? It will do it in every way.
Yeah, this plan actually very exciting, very promising. It was initiated in 2016 by the tech giant Baidu, the company, the search company, the searching engine company. According to this news release, the project named after the science fiction father, Jules Verne, is to connect top scientists and the science fiction writers. And the project, the future technological development in the cutting edges like AI or biotechnology. So you can see from the video that Liu Cixin, David Bring, Ken Liu, those science fiction writers were the first members, right? Of the institute. And also we can actually find some counterparts in the foreign Futurology institutes like XPRIZE Foundation, right? The mission of this institute is very pretty much like the SF prototyping. It's like a prototyping project. However, unfortunately, the institute seemed to stop working after a few months. We don't know why. We only see one activity happened in 2016, that was the conversation between Liu Cixin and AI expert Andrew Ng. They talked about the AI's future and how the AI would influence human society. That was a very good activity, but after that, nothing happened. Which is quite pitiful. So some similar collaboration took place for other tech tycoons, tech giants, like Professor Wu. Just talked about his collaboration with Tencent Research Institute, and that's one example we can observe. Although it didn't work out very well, but that's a good start. A second project I want to share with you is called Science Fiction Writers Walking into New State-Owned Enterprises. It's organized by the government agencies and a private science fiction cultural company called Future Affairs Administration. Since April 2016, last year, a group of science fiction writers were invited to visit some major state-owned enterprises, like the power plants, like the railway engineering equipment company, also like the power grids, right, in the western part of China. During the visit, they communicate with the engineers, with the scientists in the companies. And after the visit, if they got inspired, they can write some stories based on their visit, right? And read some of those stories they wrote. The ideas are indeed influenced by the new technology developments in those big companies. Of course, I think the communication between the scientists, engineers, and the science fiction writers is very likely one way. It's just that the science fiction writers learn from the scientists and try to get some stories inspired by the communication. But hopefully, I think the new stories they produced could be inspiration for the for the new generation, for some engineers, or for even for the new generation of students or engineering students, science students, to get involved in some in the new technology developments. That could be a two-way communication in the future. Hopefully that could be the case. So that could really help complete the cycle, right, of the science fiction and science technology development. So science and technology development inspire science fiction writers to write stories, and the stories could also inspire the new generation to make things happen, right? These are the two examples I want to share with you in terms of the how the science fiction writers are involved in some business or a corporation research or projects.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's what I want to share with you, the two examples.
Thank you very much. Yeah, that's a very interesting. That's also the government and some business sectors are also interested on this area.
Yeah. I have a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Luthan. Mm-hmm. do you know what advice American science fiction writers give to companies? Mm-hmm. For example, in Fensan's movie, there was David Breen.
David Breen, yes.
David Breen is involved with various companies in the United States. So do you know what advice?
You mean other science fiction writers, foreign or domestic writers are involved in business research?
Yeah.
In the movie, in this video, you can see not only Liu Cixin, but also Chen Qiufan. Actually, Chen Qiufan, as far as I know, Chen Qiufan, the young writer, was appointed as a member of a council member of XPRIZE Foundation. XPRIZE is a futurology oriented foundation in United States. They formed a science fiction council. And they invited Chen Qiufan as one of the members, and they conducted some projects related to futurology thinking, right? They invited the science fiction writers to write about the future of ocean, like future of ocean. There was a project I remember, and Chen Qiufan and other science fiction writers wrote stories about future of the ocean in our planet. And in China, I think those future we don't have a very good tradition of like futurist in collaboration with business. Maybe Professor Wu can share with us your collaboration with Tencent. You do have a collaboration with Tencent, right? The Tencent Research Institute. What did you guys do?
But right now, we only work with them about their game.
The game design. Okay. Yeah, that's another aspect of collaboration. Maybe not about futurology, but about the world building, game design, film advisory. Like Professor Liu Cixin, I know he participated in many film production, including Wandering Earth and other science fiction movies. He told us that he was approached by many film producers and directors. So not only him, but also other science fiction writers, they are approached by the film industry to participate in the film and the TV production. Many examples, many cases are there in China.
Thank you, Fenza. And no, now I have a question for Luthan. Now, how do American science fiction writers advise companies in America?
I think a lot of the details are under non-disclosure agreements where they don't share them very publicly. But I think that, so the specifics are perhaps beyond what I can talk about today. But more broadly, I think it's about a lot of what we've already talked about in terms of helping companies view not only their products, but the way their products will be used in different and new ways. Mm-hmm. And picking up on what was just talked about media, something that we have seen more and more interest in is not only bringing in science fiction writers to help with creating movies, but also scientists to help with creating movies. And there's sort of the famous example of the movie Interstellar, where when the scientist was collaborating to describe how to visually depict a black hole, that collaboration not only led to beautiful film, but also led to scientific discoveries. And so I think both the science community, but also those who are producing media, see relationships that can be beneficial to both sides. And I think that at the highest level, that integrating not just science fiction writers or futurists with companies, but interdisciplinary teams in general does, is it provides this new insight. It provides a new way of thinking. And so when you are working with a group of experts who have all been trained in the same way and are all used to asking each other the same questions or using the same methodologies, you tend to get the same answers. But when you bring in diversity, and whether that again is through science fiction authors or other disciplines, then you can get new questions and new methods and hopefully then new innovation. And so I think that the idea is that science fiction authors are a nice bridge because they're used to dealing in the technicalities and they're used to dealing with the science, but they also bring a narrative perspective and a futures perspective and a creative perspective to the process.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So maybe I want to share the in Japanese recent situation. So basically Japanese recent situation, the most of the author is related to the several companies, but mainly this is about the request to writing the fictions based on the technology. Like Shimizu Corporation is hiring the several sci-fi writers like Joji Hayashi or several writers writing several fictions to how the technology will be developed in the future visions. And also the Nissan Corporation, it's a car company, is also hiring several people. But there's several another aspect of the usage, like using science fiction for the warning or several security problem. Like for example, the security sector of the Japanese government is hiring about the Satoshi Hase for the writer of the Beatles. It's kind of the artificial intelligence fiction. And they also warned about the security problem of the visions. And also the Fuji Taiyo, the Taiyo Fuji is invited for the Moonshot project. It's kind of the creating the new research area, and they firstly create a visionary committee for the creating the vision. And one of the members is Fuji Taiyo. The Taiyo is and also joined about the creation of the visions. And I think that, yeah, there's several, it's kind of the non-disclosure contract. So maybe some of the people is related to the works, but I think it's these kinds of, I want to broadcast, there is many kind of the usage of the science fiction, and yeah, not only just for the advertisement, but also maybe some kinds of discussion of the ideas or making some conservative ideas of the people to making more new visions. That's in Japan situation, and maybe it's maybe we have a same situation in worldwide. And I hope for a mixture of the discussion. Thank you very much. So I want to step to the next question about the environment and around the science fiction. So because there is so much of science fiction fans in the each of the community. Mm-hmm. So I first want to ask about Professor Fenjian about the question on here. So we have an impression that there are many science fiction research clubs in university and China. So how do science fiction writers, groups, fandoms cooperate with universities? And also China's Galaxy Awards has a wide range of the categories and awards, many people. So how does such strategy help creating popularity of science fiction?
Okay, thank you for your question. The first question, let me also share the video and share the PowerPoint. The first question is about research clubs in universities. I think there are many science fiction clubs or societies in the university. formed by students. I think it's more like student interest clubs. And the recent number I got is more than 100 clubs in universities. But doing research is usually not what they what these clubs do. They are doing readings, they are doing like writings, but the researching is probably not the major mission of their of those clubs. But in terms of research in universities, I want to mention some research-oriented centers, like the Imagination Center in Shenzhen, right, in Southern University of Science and Technology. Also, there are other research centers like the China SF Science Fiction Research Center, which was just established or launched this year in Beijing. And also another one launched in, founded in 2019, last year, is SCU, Sichuan University Science Fiction Research Center. Professor Wu's student, Dr. Jiang Zhenyu was part of this research center. And I want to, and the science fiction research attracts a lot of academic attention recently. According to statistics, I can see that the more than 1,000 research articles are being published in China in the recent years. Every year, every year, more than 1,000 articles published. So that's a huge boost as compared to 10 years ago or 20 years ago. Nowadays, science fiction research is very hot in China. A noteworthy phenomenon is that some young and prominent researchers grow up as diehard science fiction fans. Like some of them I listed here, like Xia Jia, Fei Dao, Li Guangyi, and Jiang Zhenyu. They have very similar career paths or growth paths. They used to be science fiction fans, and in college they started to study science fiction, and they pursued their degrees in science fiction, and they joined universities and joined research institutes as experts in science fiction, and they chose science fiction as their research interest, and they are now very very key persons, key figures in our science fiction research community. We have a very strong and ever-growing science fiction research community in China. Mm-hmm. And going back to your question about collaboration between science fiction writers and universities, because science fiction is becoming more and more popular among young people, mm-hmm. college students. So it's very natural that those science fiction writers are invited to give talks and to participate in some science fiction related research projects in the universities. Like we invited very many science fiction writers in our classroom, and we invited them to participate in some research projects like the science fiction industry projects, right? What about the science fiction? A more interesting question is whether the science fiction writers are invited to participate in some cutting edge mm-hmm. research, right? Like the AI research. Some examples I can show you. For example, the recent example is the AI writing program developed by the Sinovation Ventures. It's a venture company. They developed AI programs to write stories, to write with AI. And Chen Qiufan is a partner with this venture. And mm-hmm. they invited 11 science fiction writers to collaborate with AI programs to write new science fiction stories. It's called a co-creation era. Hopefully, they can collaboration create some interesting stories, by AI and also by the writers. It's an interesting program. We can wait for their results, right? Their stories. I'm waiting for their stories. Mm. And your second question is about science fiction awards. It's just very interesting. I coincidentally wrote a written piece of policy paper for the government to talk about the how to develop our science fiction awards. My major point of view is that the existing top science fiction awards, like Galaxy Awards or Chinese Nebula Awards, are very crucial in making very good science fiction writers and stories known to the public. So people and outside of the community, people know about science fiction through those awards. It's very crucial, but it's still not sufficient to lead the development of the entire science fiction industry. For example, as far as I know, there are some categories of films, games in the Galaxy Award, in Nebula Awards, but there's a lack of involvement of those industry people, right? The talents of the industry, they don't really participate in these Galaxy Awards or Nebula Awards. So a proposal I made in the policy paper is that we could establish some specialized film awards or game awards to award the talents in the industry, to really involve the industry people, to make them interested in doing more science fiction related creative works, like films, like games, right? So the genre of science fiction in China is already penetrating into popular culture and into our daily life. So it's time to really set up some awards to encourage people to join this industry. So it requires cross-field collaboration to make these awards really work, right? Used to be the case that we didn't work very well for us to collaborate with the industry people in making these awards work. But hopefully the government can play a role in this awards presentation and awards organization, and the cross-field collaboration can happen and can make some impact in the development of the whole industry. So that's my answer to your question.
Thank you very much. So I think that this kind of award might be helping to influence the communities and also making an industry to joining. And it's a very good approach, because as comparing to the Japan, so it's kind of the sci-fi fandom is enthusiastic, but some old people is relatively the fans are more older and we are very surprising that there is now very young people is joining on the Chinese community and including university. And also, that might be a good idea to making some kind of award in the industry. So that's a very good, very great idea. Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah,
no problem.
Mm-hmm. And I also have a question about Ruth, about the United States situation. So how do you communicate with science fiction writers and organizers and fandom? Yeah, and how many researchers and institutes exist for literary and expressive genre of science fiction? And we also interested about the Hugo Awards sometimes emphasize the diversity. And how is the science fiction understood as a literary genre in the United States in this kind of area? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely a lot to unpack there. So if we start about how we work with writers and fandom, there are several different ways. And so one thing that we have been really fortunate to do when we work with our writers and they create stories for us is many of those are then entered into award contests. So many of the authors that we've worked with have later won awards for the pieces that they've worked on the projects. And this really helps with both gaining credibility among other writers, but also bringing awareness to the work that we've done. Specifically, when I think about fandom, I think about a project that we did called Crowd Futures a few years ago, where this was another experiment in science fiction writing that we did, but we actually crowdsourced some of the decisions that the author would make. And so there was a number of questions, and we would pose it to put it out on the internet and let people vote. what kind of story should this be? What should the theme should this be? And then the author, when there were major decisions, will put those decisions to the crowd. The crowd would decide, and then the story came out. Mm. And so that's also available. So there are different ways that we can engage different fandoms, not only in the product, or not only in the final product, but also sometimes in the production. And then pivoting to the later parts of your question, also echoing what my fellow panelists have said in terms of how science fiction is viewed and how that's changed. So when we look at science fiction in the US, we see that historically it was viewed as not a place where serious critique or serious study was happened, that science fiction was for children. It was pulp magazines and it wasn't a place of serious study. But we see that starting to change. And I think that a lot of what we've talked about today can point to the reason, or maybe at least the correlation. It's hard to tell which came first here, but that we also see a number of new programs where this is studied. So the University of Kansas has a Center for the Study of Science Fiction. We've talked about UC Riverside and their speculative fictions and cultures of science program. But it's not only English and literature departments that are investigating these questions. We also see some of this work, especially around science fiction prototyping, happening in schools of design. So at Carnegie Mellon and the Situation Lab, they're looking at how to use science fiction prototyping and other type of methods to explore these questions. And then at Arizona State, but also at other schools, you see a lot of this work happening in departments of science and technology studies. Mm-hmm. And so again, looking at training young people to think critically about what are the futures that we're doing? What is the relationship between new technologies, new innovation, and the culture in which these exist? And so one thing that I think is really interesting, again, is that at its core, this is an interdisciplinary concept. And so you can see that these similar ideas are being investigated across a number of disciplines, a number of schools. And I think that really bodes well for the future of this area.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you very much. So I think that the participatory things is working well in the science fiction, and that might be attractive. And also, yeah, this kind of work to join in the people in the discussion. So yeah, that is a very, yeah, but how to doing it, maybe, yeah, we also want to do it in same in Japan, but maybe need some modification for that. Yeah, maybe Namba-san, Yuki or Dojin, do you have any other question?
I have a question about so in Japan there is no researcher about the science fiction prototyping or some design fiction especially. But in US, there is any educational curriculum or some research center for educate the research in science fiction prototyping? Is there any educational curriculum?
So I can speak about a course that I was involved in a couple years ago that we called Science Fiction Studio. And this was a course that we only, We taught for one semester, and it was an upper division undergraduate course, but also some graduate students participated. And we were interested in teaching some of these questions. And it was not only a interdisciplinary in terms of the students that were involved, but it was actually co-taught with myself and two others. And we represented, I taught some of the learning science side. We were teaching science fiction prototyping, but specifically around educational technology. Ed Finn, who's also at the Center for Science and Imagination, taught about science fiction and the way to use narrative to inspire different product design, but also inspire people who are using the products. And then we also worked with Aaron Walker, a computer scientist, who talked about some of the technical sides. So it was a really fun class where we introduced students not only to the different disciplines, but also to the idea of science fiction prototyping or diegetic prototyping. And they created, throughout the course, they worked in teams to create product ideas, but also to create the stories behind them. And so that's one example, but there's also other work that's being done. Again, going back to the challenges that there are so many different terms being used, but we see some of these same concepts being taught in other schools where they're talking about imagination, where they're talking about critiquing of science fiction and its use in technology policy. And so again, it can be somewhat challenging to do a thorough analysis because people are using different vocabularies to describe these concepts, but I think it is growing in popularity.
Thanks.
Thank you very much, yeah.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. I think you are using sci-fi workshops and also sci-fi projects in various patterns. When points do you pay attention to when you team up with a professional science fiction writer or when you do it for citizens?
So what are the distinctions between those? Is that to understand the question?
Yeah, how do you apply to the workshop style?
Yeah, so one thing that is important is in identifying the right people to attend. And so often, especially when we were a new center and people weren't as familiar with us, we would describe the process of doing collaborative writing and working with other people. And some writers were incredibly excited about that idea, whereas others said, no, that's not part of my practice. I write by myself. And that makes sense. You know, everyone has a different practice on that. So one is that about being very transparent and clear about what our process is and looking for people who see that as an exciting challenge and one to participate in. When we're working with other communities, we also look for the same thing. We look for enthusiasm and people that are excited about this as a process. And then when we combine the two groups, one thing that's really important in our technique is that we don't tell people too much about what to expect before the workshops. So we do different world building workshops, we do different collaboration workshops, but one of the secrets or one of the keys to success is that true collaboration. So if we told people before they came, we're going to think about the future of airplane flying. And then people tend to come up with ideas on their own. And then when they come to share them, they feel a lot of ownership of their ideas. But when we don't really tell people about what we're doing before they come to the workshop, the ideas tend to be more generative and people come up with new ideas, but they also listen to other people's ideas. And so a lot of what we want when we set up our workshops is for people to be excited about what's coming, but maybe a little nervous and they don't know what to expect, so that they're open to new ideas in the conversation that emerges. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you.
So maybe we need to step to the next question about the evaluation of the sci-fi prototyping. And I think it's a very contributive area for the academic area. So so maybe I want to start with Ruth about the question. So what kind of response did you get from the actually doing the science fiction prototyping and publishing books and with authors and holding workshop to the citizens? And maybe you have already overlapped about the answer, you know, but I also want to know about the, do you have any metrics for evaluating whether SF prototyping actually worked, or is there some sort of follow-up study for checking about the effect of the science fiction prototyping? Yeah.
I love this question, but unfortunately, I'm not sure if I'm going to have a very specific answer because it is definitely an area of current and future research. So when we're thinking about responses, right now, the responses that we know are often the responses of individuals who participated in the workshops or participated in our events. And there are some common answers there. People talk about getting new ideas, both experts and science fiction authors, and that we were very happy to see that it's not just one group getting ideas from another, but this exchange of ideas crossing between science and the fiction authors. Again, this idea that bringing together people from with different experiences and different methodologies and facilitating conversation and collaboration leads to new insights that cross both spectrums. So we've felt that was really promising. Also, this is a bit anecdotal, but the fact that the people that attend our workshops often ask us if they can come back and attend more. And again, it's not strong empirical data, but it does suggest that there is value from the activities and people tend to enjoy it and report that it is shaped the way that they are thinking about their work. The idea about thinking about a metric for evaluating not just science fiction prototyping, but I'd say the use of narrative and fiction in general, again, is an area of research that I'm excited to be pursuing more. And I only wanted to highlight a few things and would love to hear from the rest of the folks on the panel in terms of insights here. But there has been some new research I was actually just seeing earlier this week about the impacts of reading climate fiction, and that it showed that when people read climate fiction, it did start to change their beliefs and attitudes about climate change. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, in the article that I was seeing, that those shifts tended to dissipate over time. So immediately after reading the fiction, people were perhaps inspired for change, or it shifted their thoughts, but that when asked a month later, they tended to revert back. And so what that suggests to me, one, is that this is an area that is really ripe for research, but also that science fiction narrative on its own isn't enough, but that it can be a good starting point for further discussion. So when you read science fiction, when you read climate fiction, and that can inspire the beginning of a change, but then there needs follow-up programming, and whether that's community programming or formal education, but that again, that and it speaks to some of the themes we've been talking about today, that science fiction and narratives in general can really provide inspiration, but then you need follow-up in order to make the most of it. But I would love also to hear others' perspectives on the role of evaluation.
Yeah.
On that note, I actually read a similar paper by a psychologist. You heard about the uncanny valley, right? People's reaction to the human robot. And a psychologist did an experiment to let the audience to read some stories and watch some AI or robot movies. And after watching those robot AI movies or read those stories, the audience feel better about these human robots. They had some compassion, they had some sympathy for those AIs, and the uncanny valley is not very steep anymore, right? The reaction to the new technological development through learning, through these science fiction stories could be better and better. And I don't know whether the reaction to the human robots will go away or not. I mean, the positive reaction could go away after the time, as time goes, but that could be a good, you know, indication for the impact of science fiction on the human psychology, right? Human's reaction.
It would be really interesting to explore, and maybe the researchers did this, but the tone of the stories and whether or not they were stories that were positive relationships humans and robots, or more of the negative relations, and how that impacts the perceptions. But yeah, I think that we've seen this also in literature in general, that it can be the gateway for inspiring more study or more thought. And I think that there's strong reason to believe that both science fiction, but also some of the science fiction prototyping tools can continue that. And again, what's critical is that we take advantage of that interest and we're able to follow up with more programming, more conversation, so that we can sustain it.
Sustain it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, so about the uncanny valley, I'm very interested about because I'm related to my areas. And but I think that uncanny valley is some kind of criticism about this kind of things might be a very low, narrow humanity notion for the acceptance. But I think if the science fiction will make a more diverse acceptance for the human acceptance, so might be a good contribution for this. And I think it's a very good study to starting and also connect to the evaluation here. Thank you very much. And also, I want to ask Professor Shenzhen about the situation in China. So is there any specific practice of the use of the science fiction? I think you already shown it, so maybe it might be okay.
Let's use some more examples, examples.
Yes.
I think by use of science fiction, I presume that you mean we utilize science fiction works, science fiction writers, their ideas to... As a method to move forward the development of the whole technology, the society, or even economy, right? I showed you some examples that how science fiction played a role in like the technology development, like the education, like the even business propaganda, public relation, right? And I want to show you two more examples. One is about education. Actually, Professor Wu Yan already talked about this. Let me see. Okay, this one. This textbook. I want to supplement a little bit about this this set of textbook science fiction. He talked about how they edited this series of textbook to try to teach students science technology and boost their imagination or protect their imagination and make sure they use their imagination in different aspects. One thing I want to mention he didn't talk about is that we had a student who tried to do some experimental study. She did an experimental study to try to evaluate the effectiveness of these textbooks or science fiction teaching in protecting or boosting students' imagination. So she did a before and after test of imagination. She developed some kind of imagination metrics or evaluation method. And she did a before and after test. In the middle, the treatment is like the teaching of science fiction, using science fiction text, right? And she's trying to find out whether the teaching of science fiction could effectively protect students' imagination and make sure they keep those imagination. And that's an interesting empirical study I want to share with you. I don't think she had the results yet. She is doing her dissertation. So hopefully we can get the results quickly, very soon. And hopefully, I think Professor Wu also talked about the workshops we are doing with the teachers, with elementary and secondary school teachers to try to teach them how to use those, to instruct them how to use those textbooks. And hopefully the textbooks and pedagogy will be used in more and more schools. And the second example I want to share is about economic development, local economic development. Oh, okay. How the local, some local governments want to use science fiction to develop their tourism economy. This is the case I want to share with you. It's in Qinghai province. It's a small town called Lenghu, or called Lake Town. In Qinghai province, it used to be a small oil base, because we found oil in that location. So the town was built in 1960s, 70s to be an oil base, but it got abandoned because of the depletion of oil in the location. So the local government thought about turning it into a tourism attraction called and they collaborated with a tourism company and also a science fiction cultural company called Eight Light Minute. These collaborations organize a very high priced science fiction writing contest, right? The competition. And they invited the science fiction writers and the public to write stories about this location, about this small town, Lenghu, because this small town has a very unique topography. It's very like Mars. You can see the picture here, right? The topography is very much like a Mars, on Mars. So like Mars. We can, and they built some very interesting capsule camp. You can see the picture here, the capsule camp. It's very much like a camp on Mars. So they inspired writers to write stories related to this small town and Mars. And the interest should be, the competition was very quite successful. It attracted not only interest, but also very much eyeballs, right? Attention is being paid to this small town. And they successfully developed this small town into an attraction, and it's branded as a mysterious Mars-like attraction. So people who are interested in Mars, they can go to this small town to experience like walking on Mars and living in the capsule camps. Similar projects are being conducted in other places like Dunhuang. You heard about Dunhuang in Qinghai province, right? They also invited the writers to write stories about this Qinghai Dunhuang culture. So the mixture of the science fiction and the local culture is very amazing. And the branding of this local attraction is also very successful in some cases. So these are the two cases I want to share with you. One is about science fiction play a role in education, imagination, protection. Also another case is about how science fiction played a role in boosting local economy. These are the two successful cases.
I love the idea about this example that you're showing about the local economies and the tourism. Yeah. And I think it is an excellent example of science fiction prototyping taken to a broader level, because that's it, right? They are creating environments for people to come and experience and then reflect on and think about what is a future where we either live on Mars or we vacation to Mars.
But that's right. That's
I think
right.
that is an I love that as an idea, and I think that it's incredibly smart and also a great way for a small town that might otherwise disappear to reinvent itself.
Yeah, if we do nothing, it's a small town will disappear for sure, but they had a great idea to turn it into an attraction. Yeah.
I love it.
With help of science fiction.
Yeah.
So sci-fi prototyping can also change our image of the location.
The image is changed for sure.
So it's very impressive. And I'd also like to ask Fen Jun about the size of the Chinese SF economy. So I get the impression that the company is also investing in it, and various agents are working together to boost SF. So how do you see the science fiction world being boosted by this trend?
We have a project, we have this science fiction industry project for many years, and Professor Wu is going to share with us the recent report, right, industry report. Professor Wu, you have the PowerPoint, right?
Okay, yes. Before that, I want to make my comment on the previous story. I should say I'm strongly support of the Ruth's idea about uncanny valley. What kind of stories you use, you know, to give the subject to read. If you use different tones, you know, to express your story, that could be totally different. I will share an experience. You know, in spare time, I always want to go to different primary and secondary school to watch their sci-fi teaching. Mm-hmm. When I was in Beijing Normal University, I had visited Beijing People's University's the high school attached to the People's University. They have a curriculum called sci-fi physics. And visited the classroom and listened to the their teaching, and we help them to do a pre-test and the you know, final test, and to try to know what kind of issues happened to the student. Most of the you know, the result is very good, but one is that looks bad is the question is, do you wish to in your grown up, you want to be a scientist? At the beginning, a large part of the student want to be a scientist, but after teaching the whole semester, they don't want to be the scientist. They know it's done. So you know, we discussed with the teacher what's happened in your teaching in different you know, stages. Why let a student have the bad image of a scientist through your teaching? So finally, they identified he used some of the movies clips to do that. Sorry, it's American movie, you know, sci-fi movies. But most of the movies, the scientist is a bad guy of that movie. So the next semester, I suggest them to try to use another movie, you know. And then this time it's not happened like that. So that is, I want to comment on the Ruth's idea. It's very agree with her. Yeah, this.
I love that example. Mm. Yeah, I think the content is key, right? That it and science fiction, like other literary genres, is so expansive, and that they're one that we haven't talked about today, but one of the focus of the work that we do at my center is about trying to create more optimistic science fiction, because so much of the science fiction that's out there is very dark, and it might inspire people, but it inspires them through fear. And so how do we inspire them through hope? And I think that that is also, you know, that's one of those challenges, and but very important to recognize that the genre cannot necessarily be used all in the same way, but that the tone of the stories, who's the good guy, who's the bad guy, this all matters in how people perceive the stories and then reflect on them in their own lives. Thank you for that example.
Mm.
We are now having a term called hope funk, hope punk, right? Hope punk. It stems from cyberpunk and trying to mobilize the writers to write some science fiction story with hopes.
Hope punk. Yeah, very great notion. Yeah, to, yeah, it's a, sometimes the science fiction is referred as a negative image also in Japan, but maybe there is more positive aspect on here, and we want to share this kind of idea to the worldwide.
Is there any statistics about some sci-fi prototyping related activities, some economic size? So is there any some data about science fiction prototyping related activities?
You mean in the overall aggregated in economic of the national economy?
So correlation of science fiction writer and the company or science fiction writer and the government.
Maybe I can answer this question. The sci-fi prototyping, as I said in the first question, the sci-fi prototyping is not a very popular concept now in China. So there are similar practices, like I mentioned, right? The local government using sci-fi as an economic development factor. Also, sub companies using sci-fi as a public relation or propaganda practices. Those practices, it's difficult for us to determine the economic, determine the values or the size of the economy, right? How much the sci-fi can contribute to this development of the local economy or the business development, we are not certain. We probably, what can we do later in our industry report is that we can probably incorporate this part. And as some case studies, in the yearbook, I remember in the yearbook, Professor Wu just showed us, right? We had some case studies, like the like how the science fiction how our center was organizing this exhibition, sci-fi exhibition in the biannual Twin City exhibition in Shenzhen, right? That's a case study. And also the case study about the science fiction magazine, the science fiction world, how the science fiction world magazine had a 40th anniversary last year. So later on, we probably will conduct some study case studies on the sci-fi prototyping and include them in our science fiction yearbook, industry yearbook.
Thanks.
Okay, so thank you so much for the very good introduction about the recent environment in China. And so about the science fiction prototyping, it's a still new notion, so we want to advertise on it. So, and also there's several, futurology is notion in the previous years about relationship of science fiction. So I think that Dojin has some question about futurology relationship.
I have a question for U-san and Ruth-san. What kind of research is being done on futurology in China and America? And how is understood? As you know, futurology and sci-fi prototyping are related, but futurology has not been sufficiently studied in Japan. So I'd like to hear your opinions. So, U-san,
okay. So beginning from China's experience, yes, during the Cultural Revolution, before Cultural Revolution, we don't know the subject like futurology or future research. But after that, China began to into the so-called period of open door policy and the reform. At this time, it began to look at the world and what's really happened in the world and found there has a futurology. Mm-hmm. So at that time, we know there has a very great futurologist is to write a book, The Third Wave. Mm-hmm. Is The Third Wave, and began to invite the writer of The Third Wave to come to China. And then suddenly, futurology is being to the big issue in China. So each year invite a lot of futurologists to visit China and help China to do the reform. But after 1989, and it looks stopped. Mm. And then the new areas, there has nearly 10 years the futurology not very popular in China. Mm. But beginning from the new century, because of the new technology and the world changed, and the futurology turned to be more and more in China now. So what's the difference between these two period of time? The first period of time, the China tried to know what's happened in the world, especially the third wave, and then try to catch the third wave. Hmm. But this time, more of the research related to strategy of development. So a lot of conference and talking about the strategy of the later 2050 or 2075, beginning to study about that. That is what I think of the difference of these two period of time. And this time, the book we translated from the other country is the Brave History of the Future, Brave History of Humanity. Oh, this kind of book, very popular inside China.
Mm. Thank you.
Ruth, do you have any idea? Yeah.
Sure. Definitely getting a little bit outside of my expertise to talk about the history of a discipline. But from my perspective, I think it's also starting to become more formalized as a discipline. So you saw individuals doing future work or working with companies as futurists, but the idea that futurology or future studies as a formal discipline is still relatively new. There's definitely a history there, but it's becoming more formalized, and I'd say particularly as an academic area of interest. So there was work happening in corporations and some government work, but there is continued interest in formalization around future studies and futurology from an academic perspective.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, okay, so we have not so much time now. So maybe the last question, it might be very short, but I want to ask about the future of science fiction prototyping itself. So I want to know the future of the future visions. Yeah. So about the question, Ruth, so I think you work to spread science and technology to the women, and also you're expert on HCI and education, right? So I want to know about how this kind of technology, like STEM education or some kind of area, and how it the sci-fi prototyping approach will emphasizing the STEM education and diversity and the challenge and breadth of these kind of areas. Yeah.
Yeah, I think we've talked hit on several of these concepts already, but to recap some of the challenges facing the field. We've already spoken about this, but this idea of creating more hopeful or optimistic stories, I like the term hope punk. Mm-hmm. And I think moving away from the dystopias, again, not to say there's not value in the dystopias, but there's definitely a lot of them. And there's good reason for that. They make great stories. There's reason for that, but how do we create visions that people want to build and that people want to work towards? Another is about, as you mentioned, increasing the diversity and representativeness of people that are included in these stories. It's hard to get excited about the stories you read about the future if you don't see yourself represented in those stories. And so how do we not only expand the diversity of the characters, but the diversity of the people creating those stories so that lived experiences are represented in tomorrow's science fiction. And then just to speak briefly about science fiction prototyping as a tool, something that I hope to see in some of the work that we're trying to do at the center is moving this away from a tool that is only used by or primarily used by companies or as an academic exercise, and thinking about how to get these tools about science fiction prototyping or more imagination methods more broadly into communities to address real questions and real needs. So I think that as a field, we have a lot of resources, but they tend to be privileged to those who with money. And then how do we get these imagination tools, of which I see science fiction prototyping as one of them, into more diverse communities and to be meeting real needs? And so one of the projects I'm really excited about that we're launching at the center is about applied imagination, and specifically thinking about how do we train people up in these tools so that the challenges that they're addressing are not ones that are just generated by academics or corporate minds, but based on communities and seeing, you know, where do these tools fall short and where can they be improved? So I think that there's a lot of work to be done, but there's also a lot of reason for hope and optimism that these tools can be used to make real and again, sustainable change.
Thank you very much. So yeah, the Professor Wu, so you have been working the novels for many years, and you're now doing the science fiction research and writing books for novel for children. So from this perspective, what you expect in the future, future of the SF prototyping as a various possibility and challenges on this area? What do you want to do in future? Yeah.
Yes, I you know, most of my work recently is more or less related to the future. Mm-hmm. Imagination, science fiction, future studies, you know, and also strategies. What I'm thinking about the you know, the future in my generation, you know, I'm born from 1960s, so it's always have the spirit of hope, mm-hmm. you know, to think about the future. We will have the method to solve the problem. But in the recent couple of years, I really don't think it's a good year for, especially for the international situation, you know, the trade war and the epidemic and this kind of things. So it will create more, you know, depressed in the general people's mind. Mm-hmm. So that is why I wrote a novel. It will launch the next year, next January. It's talking about things happened in my childhood. It's at that time, it really is a memory of my childhood, but I put science fiction inside. It's talking about in 1972, at the year China and the United States have the formal relationship, you know, about began to talk to each other. And at the same time, China want to launch a man-made spaceship. Mm. Yeah. And finally, it's not success. But at that time, I was a child, so I know I look at what happened, mm-hmm. the world. Try to give people some hope. Mm. That is what I think.
That's a great point, yeah. So Professor Jan, do you have any additional comments for that? Yes.
Yeah, about sci-fi prototyping, I think it's, I must say it's a very good brand. It's a very good brand. And good. We are, I understand that after 2010-2011, the term has been getting picked up by many academic, by many practitioners, and I think this is the term we are very you know, lucky to have to do something, you know, in either you do future projection, future vision, or future study, or you try to use science fiction to do study, to do education, or to even boost the local economy. We can use this umbrella term to form a so-called methodology, right, for us to brand this practice, and also to make forward, to put forward our effort to make things happen. So I think what I'm looking forward to do in the near future is to really spread the term in China, right? We are forming some projects using the sci-fi prototyping as the brand, right? And we are also talking to some ventures, or talking to some business people to try to inject this concept into their minds, to let them know that we have these tools, we have this tool, we have a sci-fi prototyping tool to help your business development, to help your local development, so on and so forth. And that could be a future, a part of my future work. And I'm also talking to some writers like Chen Qiufan. Chen Qiufan might be a very good partner with me. He is very future oriented. He's doing a lot of future oriented sci-fi writing. He wrote a lot of stories in near future. So he branded his sci-fi writing as so-called science fiction realism. Science fiction realism. So we will work together to put forward this sci-fi prototyping concept and make things happen. So that's one of my you know, duties and what I want to do in the near future. Maybe with Ross, with Arizona Center. Actually, I sent, I think in terms of the translation of the book, right, I mentioned in the beginning, we sent a letter to copyright request letter to Brian last year. He said that he had a manager agent in Beijing, and we translated the first two chapters and we tried to approach the publisher. And because of the trade war professor we mentioned, right, you know, it's very difficult for Chinese publishers to publish some American writer's book. So we are waiting for things to turn around, right? Or maybe we can try to publish this book in some other ways. I myself are writing some books to introduce articles or books to introduce this sci-fi prototyping concepts. Your congress or your meeting is very, very much timely, and we can work together to make some impact in both China and Japan.
And I hope to speak also to the very near future. I hope that all of us can continue these conversations and collaborations, because
that's right.
I've definitely learned a lot in this conversation today, and am so happy to see the similarities between the work that we're doing, and mm-hmm. look forward to hopefully many more conversations together.
That's right.
Thank you very much. So Namba-san, Miyamoto-san, do you have any other comments on here?
Okay, today's whole comment about, I'm very excited and encouraged to study and to research and think about sci-fi prototyping and using to envision the future and to make the future. So also, especially so, Rustan said to not only economic purposes or the not only collaboration with government or company, but also to use science fiction power to make the society more diversity, to give more diversity, or give the power and encourage all the people. So I have the hope to use science fiction to encourage this society and make the hope. So it's very interesting and exciting today's panel discussion. Thank you for all.
Now, today's Congress was very interesting to see various practices of sci-fi prototyping. I found a lot of possibilities that I haven't noticed before, and I felt hopeful about sci-fi prototyping. And I would also like to talk with various science fiction researchers from around the world, not only China, America, and Japan, and connect with them. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for participating in this panel talks. And I'm also very excited about hearing the several examples, and also our challenge will be same direction. So maybe there is some kind of conflict might be happens, and sometimes from country to country, but we are all humans and we all have the same problem on the future vision. So maybe we can share the knowledge each other with a continuing discussion on here. Yeah. And again, thank you so very much, San. I want to finalize this panel talk, and to the listeners. Yeah. Thank you very much. So yeah, see you maybe next time. Yeah.
Take care.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah, take care about the situation. Yep. Yeah.